In this fourth post on neural networks, we're going to see how neural networks learn or are trained. In the first post, we looked at the anatomy of a neuron. This includes its inputs, outputs, weights, a bias, and an activation function. The second post took a closer look at non-linear activation functions. And in the third installment, we saw how we could link neurons in layers, with the activations of neurons in one layer feeding the neurons in the next, all the way until an output layer. The output layer provides the results of the task that the network has been trained to learn. In the third post, we also suggested that a neural network could be regarded as a function. Yes, a crazily complicated function, but a function nonetheless. It has a bunch of inputs and a bunch of outputs. Crucially, it has a large number of parameters named weights and biases. It's these weights and biases in each neuron that we can tweak. This tweaking is what allows the network to learn a pattern or a mapping between inputs and outputs. Let's get a little bit more formal with that a neural network could be regarded as a function statement. Functions can be written out, so let's write down what a neural network looks like as a function. To make things a little easier to digest, let's not write out the whole thing in one go. Instead, let's look at the function from layer to layer, from the input layer through the hidden layers, and finally to the output layer. Up to this point, we've been looking at equations for a single neuron. While we can continue to write out the equations in this form, it's more legible and more compact to use matrix notation. If we want to calculate the activations in neurons A1, A2, and A3, we'll multiply the activations of the neurons in the previous layer, here H1 through H4, with their associated weights. We then add each neuron's bias and apply the activation function, here denoted as F. We can use vectors to represent each layer. The elements in each vector represent the activation of each neuron in that layer. We can also use a vector to represent the biases of every neuron in that layer. The weights that multiply the activations in the previous layer can be held in a matrix. This vector and matrix notation helps us write out the equations in a way that they'll generalize to any shape and size of network. So let's represent our inputs as a vector, x, and our outputs as a vector, y. We'll call our first hidden layer H1. If we have n inputs and m neurons in our first hidden layer, and if all inputs are connected to every neuron in this first layer, then we can describe the weights connecting these neurons as an n by m matrix. Let's call this matrix W1. Every one of the neurons in this layer will have a bias, so we'll need a vector for that too. We'll call that B1. Finally, we'll need an activation function to generate the output of each neuron. We'll call that F1. That means that we can write out the function to calculate all of the activations in our first hidden layer with the equation you see on your screen. If we want to write the function that generates the activations in the ith hidden layer, then we can simply write it as you see on your screen until we reach the output layer, when our output vector will be as you see here. The subscript final denotes the final hidden layer. Written this way, we have a recursive set of formulae that generate our output from our input. You can see how you can get to the output y from the input x. Much more importantly, you can see that you, or someone you know, could write the code in Java or Python or some other language to calculate y from x. This would mean writing some loops for the matrix multiplication, doing some addition of the bias terms, and coding the algorithm of whatever activation functions that you choose. But hopefully, even the most cynical among you can concede that this is a realistic endeavor. Seen in this way, I hope you agree that a neural network is just a function that maps a vector of inputs x into a vector of outputs y. So in this post, we're going to focus on what we call supervised learning. For this, we need a bunch of associated input and output pairs. That is to say, some data, e.g. an option price as an output, and some input data, for instance, the time series of an underlying, that gives rise to the particular output. You can't have too much training data. The more associated pairs of data you have for training, the better your results will be. The only substitute for training data is even more training data. No shortcuts, no free lunch. Get your hands on as much training data as you possibly can. So armed with as much training data as you can, you're now ready to train your network. This is essentially a brute force approach. What we'll do is nudge the weights and biases in each neuron in the network so that our AI is able to generalize. That is, it's able to come up with sensible outputs for sets of inputs that it has not seen in its training set. It really is no more complicated than one. Show some inputs and measure the accuracy of the associated outputs. Two, nudge the weights and biases a little. Three, repeat that until satisfied. We're going to focus on step one for the remainder of this post and leave steps two and three for the next installment. Now, let's talk about this mysterious cost function. Actually, it's not that mysterious. All it is a way of measuring how good or how bad the network is at predicting the correct output while the network is learning. The cost function heavily penalizes the network for really bad outputs. That is to say, the network's outputs that are a long way from the target output in the training set. As in life, high costs are bad and lower costs are good. For high costs, that is to say, large deviations from the correct output, we'll want to nudge our weights and biases more. For a low cost, that is to say, outputs that are close to the correct answer, we might only want to tweak the weights and biases just a little. So we can start with a complete random initialization of our weights and biases in the network. Then we can present our first input. Let the network do its multiplication, bias addition, and activation thing, and let the outputs from one layer feed into the next. This is referred to as a forward pass. At the end of this forward pass, with randomly initialized weights and biases, you would expect a truly awful output. If this is your expectation, you'll usually not be disappointed. A network with random weights will be terrible at getting anywhere close to the correct answer. You can subtract the output calculated by the network from the output you expect and get an error. This error tells us how far the network was from the correct answer. You'll often hear this error referred to as the loss. You can then repeat this for a bunch of other examples in the training set. This is the sequence. Plug in the input data, let the network calculate the output with one forward pass, then compare the calculated output to the output you expect. As you continue with this, you'll get some negative errors, that is to say underestimates, as well as positive errors, overestimates. You'll want all the errors to be cumulative. That's to say, you don't want positive errors to cancel out negative errors. A common tactic for dealing with this is to square the error, as a square will always be positive. Or just take the absolute value of the error by ignoring any negative signs. Thus, a common choice of cost function is the sum of the squared errors. Better still, the mean of the sum of the squared errors. That will normalize the answer. This means that at the end of a training run, by showing a whole bunch of input and output data to our network and comparing the outputs we calculate to the outputs we expect, we can sum the square of the errors, take the average, and get a single number. That number quantifies how good, which would be a low cost, or how bad, a high cost, our network is. Remember also that our network is a function, mapping inputs to outputs, y vectors from x vectors. If we decide that our cost function is the mean of the squared errors, or MSE, that becomes the equation on your screen, where y-train is the correct output from our training set, and y-network is what our network calculated. You'll hear these training runs referred to as epochs, and at the end of every epoch, we can calculate the aggregate cost. We can use this cost and some fancy calculus to nudge our weights and biases to get a better set of outputs on the next epoch. The whole phrase cost function neatly sums things up. The cost bit measures how good or bad the network is. The function bit means that the function can be differentiated. We'll see in the next post how we use calculus to get the derivatives of the cost function and use these derivatives as a mechanism to update our weights and biases. So in summary, we've seen how we can represent the neural network as a function. We've applied a cost function to measure how accurately, or otherwise, the network has learned the mapping between the inputs and the outputs while training. Then we've looked at the mean squared error as a good choice of cost function. This ticks a lot of boxes. It ensures that positive and negative errors are cumulative rather than cancelling each other out, and it normalizes the error by taking an average. In the next post, we'll see how we can use the derivatives of the cost function to get a strategy to tweak the parameters of the network after every epoch. This goes by the formal name of backpropagation.